everybody. This is Marcel Patut, and welcome to another edition of Sports Inquirer Show. We're recording this on June 15th, 2020. Hope all of you are well and safe out there in the world. There's a lot going on out there, and I thank you for taking a few moments to listen to our show and everything that we're doing here on our site, which is thesportsinquirer.net, premier site for news and notes in the world of sports. We've done some exciting updates of our archives and our layout, so make sure you check that out and see everything that we're doing. Also head to our social media platforms, starting with Twitter and Instagram, and you can search Sports Inquirer. That's all one word. You do a search there, you follow us, and we will greatly appreciate it. And we do greatly appreciate it, those of you that do currently follow everything that we're doing. You can also head to Facebook and our two pages on there. One is The Sports Inquirer, and the other one is Sports Inquirer, all one word. Go to either one of those pages, follow that same drill, and we will greatly appreciate that you follow us there and show your support. Also, subscribe to us on iTunes and on SoundCloud under The Sports Inquirer. Make sure you go onto there, and you can get our subscribe there, and you can get access to all of our archives of our previous Sports Inquirer shows, as well as Verbal Submission, which is our combat sports-based show. And also Backdoor Cuts, and which is about basketball and everything in between. So make sure you head to those sites or those social media platforms and check out everything that we are doing. On today's show, we're going to break down MLS's back tournament. Major League Soccer announced that it's returning to play with a World Cup style tournament. We'll break that down in the original free kick. Then we'll delve into the stagger screen portion of our show, where we discuss the NBA's return plans and have some thoughts on that. And then finally, Miscellaneous Department will discuss the world of sports and politics continuing to find its way weaving together. NASCAR banning the Confederate flag. PGA Tour was back in action this weekend. And Major League Baseball's continued struggles of returning to the field. But we're going to start off back to my first topic, which is the original free kick as the MLS is back tournament. So yeah, Major League Soccer played about two or three regular season games before it was postponed due to the coronavirus and everything going on there. If you're listening to the show, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But they have announced a return to play. They're going to play MLS's back tournament in Orlando, Florida. Teams will begin arriving in Orlando as soon as June 24th for preseason training. Now, the teams are able to train in their own facilities and wherever they are playing. All the teams are involved, and they're going to train in Orlando, I said, as early as June 24th and be able to participate in the event. I was able to get access to, in courtesy of Atlanta United Communications, Brad Guzan, talking about training for Orlando and preparing for the tournament. Let's get his thoughts before I break down the tournament itself. So here's Brad Guzan discussing that.
We had small group training at the end of last week to Saturday and then Monday. So, you know, it's only been a couple days. But, yeah, it's been good. You know, being able to see guys, just laugh and joke, check in on guys, make sure everyone's doing well. You know, everyone's got kind of their own thing going on. And so to be able to now have everyone in the same place, same time, that part's been really good. And, you know, as much as it certainly has a little bit of a feeling of preseason, we also have the understanding that it's not right. And this isn't preseason. This is, we need to try to accelerate our progress, from a physical standpoint, from a mental standpoint, from a team chemistry standpoint, all those little variables that hopefully will allow us to be clicking in full gear come the first game down in Orlando. So it has a preseason feel to it, but you almost can't allow yourself to have that mentality because we got to make sure we hit the ground running.
And that was Brad Guzan discussing the return to training for the team. Also, Jake Mulraney also spoke about that the team's return to play and getting back onto the field. And his return, he was a new member of the team, and him getting back into the flow of training as the team prepares to go to Orlando. So here is Mulraney discussing that.
No, there was none of that. I think I was with the team for nearly. Yeah, I wasn't with them long at all. But no, it's been good. I'm glad to get back into it. We done a couple of 11v11s, and obviously, like, you can do all the running in the world, you can do all the sessions you want, but when it comes to the proper stuff, it's a completely different ball game. I remember I think it was the first day back, Brooks had it in the far corner, and like there was no one within toward the yard because everyone was just tired after the first half an hour. But I mean, yesterday was a lot better. Everyone looked a lot sharper, a lot fitter. But again, it'll take 2 or 3, 4, 5 maybe of them for everyone to get up to speed. I reckon.
And now is Jake Mulraney discussing his return to training, or the team return to training, him acclimating himself into the team. So the way the tournament's going to work, similar to the FIFA World Cup format, tournament will feature a continuous schedule of matches nearly every day. Each team will play in 3 group stage matches, and those results are going to count towards the 2020 MLS regular season standings. So if you're familiar with the World Cup, teams are into different bracketed groups of 4, and they play each other, and the top, usually 2 teams from each bracket, or each group, I should say, advance to the knockout stage of the tournament, and it includes a round of 16, quarterfinals, semifinals, and a championship match, which will take place on August 11th. And matches tied at the end of regulation in the knockout phase, they're going to go directly to penalty kick shootouts. So you're not going to have the 2 15-minute halves or of extra time, as in the no golden goals scenario or the end of the 30 minutes. They can go straight to the penalties in that regard. With Major League Soccer, they have to work with U.S. Soccer, Canada Soccer, CONCACAF to work all of this out. And one kind of twist in this is that there is the Scotiabank CONCACAF Champions League spot will be earned by the team that went for the 2021 tournament, will be earned by the team that wins the MLS Is Back tournament. So not only will it lead to regular season standings, a championship berth or berth in the Champions League is on the line. So usually the way that teams are able to get into the Champions League in many ways, you can win your domestic cup, the U.S. Open Cup for the United States, for example. You can win the Supporters' Shield, which is the most points in the regular season, at least as far as MLS goes. You can win the MLS Cup itself, and that'll get you into the tournament. Now, this berth here, the win the MLS Back tournament, is going to replace the berth previously awarded to the MLS regular season points leader in the conference, opposite of the 2020 Supporters' Shield winner. So there's a little bit of a change there as far as the way things are going to lay out. Brad Guzan discussed the CONCACAF Champions League berth and what that will mean towards the teams that are participating in the MLS's Back tournament. So here's Brad Guzan.
I certainly think it puts an emphasis on the knockout stages, because we all know, we all had a pretty good idea that the first 3 group games were going to be tied to the league standings and point total for our league standing position. So that part, there's no problem in terms of, you know, if you want to call it motivation or whatnot, right? Those are obviously massive games. But we didn't understand and we didn't know what was going to be the incentive, for those groups, for the knockout stages, sorry. And, you know, not that you'd go in and, you know, chuck a game, but, you know, you have to think about the safety of players from a physical standpoint, the safety of players just from being down there, obviously. And so now that they put a Champions League berth at the end of it, I think, certainly creates that ambition to obviously win the tournament. And we all understand, you know, what Champions League means and what's it it's all about. And as a club that's been there, that's certainly a goal of ours. So Yeah, I think it gives those knockout games that much more meaning.
And that was Brad Guzan discussing the CONCACAF Champions League berth and what that would mean to the team. And in addition to the matches that count in the regular season standings in the Champions League berth, players will have the opportunity to earn an additional bonuses as part of the $1.1 million prize pool. So that's the layout. That's what they're going to do. And after the MLS's back tournament, I guess the goal or the intention is for teams to go back to their home cities and be able to host matches. As I said, we're recording this on June 15th. By the time they get back to their home cities, which will be after August 11th, fans may be able to get access to the games. And we'll discuss a little bit later throughout the show just how different leagues are approaching it. But we've seen the Bundesliga in Germany. They've been hosting matches on their home fields of their respective teams. No fans in the stands, but they've been able to do that and have teams travel there. We saw in New Zealand that they had a professional rugby tournament or an event, and they had 20,000 plus fans at the two events or the 2 days of activities. But they've had no new cases, I think, in the past 2 or 3 weeks. And they had less than 2,000 cases overall with the coronavirus. So obviously New Zealand, different layout as compared to the United States and Canada. That's impacted by MLS, but still they have been able to have fans hosted at their in an arena style or a soccer stadium style arena. So that's something to consider as well. But Brad Guzan once again talked about the health issues that come along with hosting a tournament of this magnitude as far as MLS is back. So let's hear from Brad Guzan again.
In touch with them. Obviously our PA staff is kind of, constantly monitoring the situation. Because from the time that the negotiations had finished to obviously the time when teams would essentially be leaving, a lot can happen. One of the questions that wasn't really talked about, but we're in the middle of hurricane season. And what happens if a hurricane or a tropical storm rolls through? What does that do to the timeline? What does that do for just being safe? So there's obviously a bunch of different variables, but, we're definitely in touch with them. We were on a call with our health, our health doctor who's kind of leading the charge for the players. Those conversations are constant and ongoing. What I would say is I've seen those same reports, those same tweets about over the last week. I think a couple days ago, it was over the last 3-4 days where they had a spike in cases. That's certainly not ideal for us.
And that was Brad Guzan talking about the health issues that can come with it. And finally, let's hear from him one more time, mentally preparing to go to Orlando and participate in the tournament.
Orlando was voted on, it was passed, and now we have to go out and perform. And so it's as simple as that. And, we I think as a group, when you cross the white line, you play as normal. But obviously the whole quarantine, the whole bubble, that part of it, that remains to be seen.
And that was Brad Guzan once again talking about the team and mentally preparing to just when he figures that once they go down there, it will be full activity and full action. Now, Atlanta United itself is a seeded team in Group E and are joined by Eastern Conference opponents FC Cincinnati, New York Red Bulls, and Columbus Crew. And as I mentioned, all those teams will have the matches count towards the regular season standings. Now, as far as off the field, the other announcements, the MLS midseason window or transfer window is going to run from July 7th to Wednesday, August 5th. So as I said, they start the matches on as early as, Atlanta United's first match is going to be on August 5th. So they have August 5th and then July 5th, And the transfer window starts July 7th. So Carlos Bocanegra, he spoke the technical director of Atlanta United, and I don't think you'll see too many moves from him or from other teams as far as bringing players in and out. Because normally you have the option of bringing the players in, but there's so many loopholes now or so many hurdles to move over to find your way onto a team. The teams have not been able to evaluate other players completely. There have been lack of play around the league, lack of international tournaments, especially at the youth level or the U21s and U23s and below. All of those have been postponed, of course, due to the virus. So scouting has been limited. Even USL players, which Atlanta has a Atlanta United too, and the United States Soccer League, the USL Championship, they have been on hiatus as well. So there has been less availability of seeing players at that level if you wanted to transfer them in from there. Now, if you bring a player in, you have to send them right to Orlando and into the bubble. They'll have to be tested and probably quarantined for a certain amount of time. So bringing players in as far as this point goes is going to be very difficult. Now, I think you can see some player movement and activity maybe towards the end of the tournament, especially if a team is eliminated from the MLS's back tournament. They play their three matches and they'll head on home. They could probably sign a player in the first few days of August and then implement them into the lineup and the roster when the teams are able to play matches on the home fields. And actually, I have to correct myself, the MLS back tournament starts on July 8th, not July 5th, as I stated earlier. So you can technically bring a player in on July 7th, have them part of your roster for July 8th when the tournament begins, but that's a one-day turnaround. They still have to figure out, I think the squad that you bring into the tournament is probably the squad, as far as the roster goes, of who you have to stick with. And it's still a work in progress because there's still issues. What if a player gets injured? Can you bring someone up from your USL team, like Atlanta United 2? Can they come up to go down to Orlando and play? The USL Championship, they're playing matches themselves. They're going to try to play. So what happens there? It's a lot going on with that. But at least Major League Soccer has made an announcement as far as what they are trying to do. They're working through it like every other league is. And will it work out? We will see. I think once the teams head down to Orlando, they'll be able to figure out. And it's going to be unique because the matches they have scheduled time-wise, they're going to have matches, I think, 9:30 Eastern Standard Time. And then the next set of matches is going to be, I think, at 9:30 and 10:30 p.m. So no matches in the middle of the day. I guess they want to avoid the Orlando heat because it gets really hot down there. But they have to get a lot of matches in, and you have to consider as well, and I have family in Orlando, I know this directly, and we've all been to Florida, or at least at some point in our lives. It rains a lot. It's a lot of storms. It's hurricane season. There's a lot going on down in Orlando, so they have to figure all of that out. But they've made some steps in trying to head in a direction of the players getting their ways back onto the field. Another league that's made an announcement of trying to get back onto the field is the Stagger Screen portion of our show, discussing the NBA. They made an announcement last week with the Board of Governors and the Players Association that they're going to have a 22-team, 8-game wrap-up to the regular season, followed by a possible play-in tournament for the 8th seed of the NBA playoffs. And they're going to try to resume this 2020 season on July 31st inside the Walt Disney World's ESPN Wide World Sports Complex. So they're going to be in Orlando too. And their familiarity, and I should say this for MLS as well, Orlando's a very popular location because they host a lot of events. And not only do they have Disney World, they host a lot of tournaments, they have the fields and the course to do it. NBA has one portion of their summer league in Orlando, so the facilities are very familiar to the NBA players and coaches. They've all at some point have at least been to Orlando and know the layout of it. Major League Soccer, not only did they have an Orlando team with Orlando City, as far as the professional team goes, but a lot of teams have their preseason camps in that area. So there's fields to play there. So that's why Orlando, once again, was chosen for the NBA. Game 7 of the NBA Finals will not take place later than Monday, October 12th. And that's so the season's going to start, the resumption of the season, July 31st. So that gives them a few months to try to get all these games in. And if there's no need for a play-in tournament to establish the eighth seed, see the teams in the Eastern and Western Conference, they're going to start the playoffs a few days early. So once they finish the regular season among the 22 teams that go for the 16 playoff spots, I think if there's a squad within one or two games of the eighth seed, that's when they're going to have the play-in tournament. But if they don't have that, they're going to keep playing, or they're going to go straight to the playoffs. And the teams that are not in Orlando for the tournament, including the Atlanta Hawks, and we'll get to the Hawks in a minute here in Atlanta, they're going to try to participate in mini camps of some sort later on this year. They don't want to have 10 months off between games. And we don't know if they're going to be in Orlando as well. I assume not in Orlando, even though a centralized location would benefit all parties involved. But we don't know what's going to happen to teams like the Phoenix and the Hawks and teams that are in the Knicks, teams that are in the lower part of the standings, of what they're going to do there. But the draft lottery is still going to be scheduled, or they're going to schedule it for August 25th, with the draft itself on October 15th. So once they finish the regular season, those teams that are not in the playoffs will be put into the lottery. And I know this was going to be the first year that, well, actually, I have it right here. The 14 teams that ultimately are not in the playoffs are going to be in the lottery. The lottery order is going to be based off of the standings as of March 11th, when the season was suspended. So in case those other teams aren't able to play their scrimmages and all that other stuff, they want to make it be fair and objective in that way. And they were going to have the format, the traditional format we had was the lottery teams either staggered in order of most likely to win the lottery, so with the ping pong balls and things like that. So if you had the worst overall record, you have more ping pong balls in the machine. And the way would be, if you were the worst team, you have a 25% chance around that range to get the number one overall pick, and then you go down from there all the way to about 1% for the 14th team in the lottery. They were going to change it this year to not having it that drastic and having the teams with the three worst records have an equal slot of winning that pick. So it goes down to about, I think, 15%, and then going on from there. I don't know if they're going to keep that format because, once again, fluid situation. That's the recording this right now. By the time we do our next show, we might have an announcement about that. But they're just trying to get back onto the court, and that's the biggest thing. And Trae Young was able to speak with the Atlanta Hawks Atlanta media. And thank you once again to the Atlanta Hawks Communications for the audio we're about to play. But here was Trae Young talking about the season ending and what it meant for the team.
I was mad. I was frustrated. Obviously, I want to play. I want to play as much as I can. I understand what the NBA did, and I respect their decisions. They want to make it as safe as possible, and maybe taking lesser teams will make that possible. And then rather than us just going out there and playing some games just to finish our season. So I understand what was said, obviously, or what was made, but I obviously I'm kind of upset because I want to play.
And that was Trae Young discussing the conclusion of the NBA season for the Hawks, and he also delved into areas of improvement in his game and what he's going to try to do in his third year in the league coming up.
Of course, I did. I worked too hard not to believe that. So for me, I believed it. I believe in the work I put in, and I feel the work I put in is going to translate to on the court. And that's all I've been trying to do, and that's all I'm doing right now. It's try to elevate my game so that, I mean, we're in a better position next year. So that's definitely what I've thought. For me, I want to continue to get better in all areas. I think for me and my game to grow and take it to even a higher level is just my conditioning. I mean, my shape, being able to play at 100% for a long period of time on both ends. I think for me, just trying to get in shape and make sure that I'm able to play super hard on both ends is going to be very important for me going into next year. For sure. So, yeah, playing that game the other day, I was just itching to play. I've been just wanting to play. I was actually one of the first times I touched the ball in a long time. So I was just trying to find some run and wanted to make sure it was safe for me to even go out there and play the safest way. But I just wanted to go out and just play and just have fun and just play again. Like it's been a long time for me. I don't know when the last time I've been 3 months without playing a game, 4 months without playing a game. And I'm definitely, we've been talking, and I've been talking with Cam, John, Clint, everybody, Kev, about meeting up or just after everything we know that's going to go on and just getting some workouts in. I mean, whether it's in Atlanta or out here in Vegas, like it's wherever it is, we're going to get some work in together. We can't go 5-6 months without seeing each other and getting some work in with each other because we're trying to take this to new heights next year. And so for us to do that, we got to have, I mean, a close connection and a close bond. And I know, I mean, just working together is going to do that.
And that was Trae Young discussing areas of improvement. And finally, he discussed his expectations for the upcoming, 2021 season, what he wants to see from the team and himself as they continue their rebuild.
Getting better each and every year. And I can't wait to see guys like Cam and Dre and their progress and what they're going to come back next year doing. And if we're all on the same path and we're all getting better each and every year, I think this next year is going to be really good for us, especially with John going into his fourth year, me going into my third, Kev, same thing. I think we're all at that point now where we're starting to, I mean, be more comfortable. And I'm excited about getting to play with Clint, and it's gonna be fun. And I think it's I don't necessarily wanna say too much about what I expect next year, but it's gonna be big things for sure.
And now it's Trae Young discussing the team and what he wants to see from them overall. Now we've also the news came out over this weekend. It's not necessarily news, but the announcement of the return of the NBA and everything like that, we knew not everyone would be in agreement with it. And even with the votes, with the owners for this new deal, 29 out of 30 teams approved it. One team didn't. The Portland Trailblazers didn't. So we all know that there's disagreements and discernments. But Kyrie Irving, the guard for the Brooklyn Nets, discussed his displeasure with the teams returning to play in Orlando. And I think his point has been, and this has been leaked out, I don't think we've heard from him directly about it, but his point is that there's a lot going on in the world right now. And we've talked about it in our previous shows. We all know what's going on, from the fatalities of George Floyd and others around the nation. And we just had an incident in Atlanta this past weekend as well, with police brutality, with minorities, specifically black people, and everything going on there. So we're not a political show, but you know what's going on. So he's saying with all of these things going on that the league should not return to play, should be focused on other things. And Dwight Howard of the Lakers, the center for the team, he's standing behind, he's agreeing with Kyrie Irving. And then we have Austin Rivers, the guard for, I believe he's on the Rockets right now. He's saying that we can do both. We can, as players, the players that they can play on the court and be participating in this season and have a vocal voice in the, as far as protesting and expressing their opinions, things along those lines. I understand both sides of it. Personally, I think that more can be accomplished by the players participating in the in the tournament, or not tournament, in the, well, it ends up being a tournament with the playoffs, but returning to play. It's not like the NFL where there's been a tremendous amount of dissension between ownership and the commissioner, Roger Goodell, and the players. I think the NBA players have been very vocal, and before all of this happened, about what's been going on in the world and expressing their opinions on racial issues and gender issues and things along those lines. I don't think that if LeBron James or James Harden or Chris Paul, you know, top players in the league, all the way down to a reserve or a bench player, if they want to, they've been able to wear shirts, they've been, the social media, they've been very active. I don't think that there's going to be a disagreement or they're going to be looked down upon for expressing themselves in that way. So I don't think there needs to be a complete shutdown or in essence, what Kyrie wants is a strike. He's not saying the word strike, but he wants the players not to play. And I think you may have some players that do that. And it may be, the thing about Kyrie Irving also, and that's where the problem, well, not a problem, but the thing is, he's not the best source for this opinion. We know he has his mind works differently, and that's not a bad thing. But from the earth being flat to, I think, an elitist attitude that he has in some ways, being a player from Duke and all that other stuff, it does play into his opinion of things. But what he's saying is not completely off, but you have to look at it from his perspective, and also you have to look at it for on the court. He's out for the season, he had surgery, so he's not coming back to play. If he was completely healthy and Kevin Durant, his teammate, was completely healthy and they were in a position to be a championship contender, would he be saying this, or would he be trying to get guys back on the court? Would he be like Harden and LeBron James and Giannis and players that realize that they're, and I would say Kawhi, but he talks to nobody, but players that are in line to contend for a championship? Would he have that same opinion? He's playing with house money. He already isn't coming back himself, because he could use a legitimate reason for him not playing is that he's recovering from surgery. So we could have that opinion of, guys, we should not play, because he's not playing anyway. And his team is really not in contention for a title, because him and Durant, their two best players, aren't going to be playing. Now, the Nets are in playoff, be in contention for a playoff spot, but we know that they most likely will not be contending for a championship. And Dwight Howard's in a different spot. He's with the Lakers. They have the best record in the West. They're major contenders for a championship. So I'm looking at it from a basketball perspective. He might be a little bit different, but I think you're going to have some players not play for several reasons. And this goes back to MLS as well. We have already heard players that have pregnant spouses or pregnant girlfriends or their significant others, I should say, or live with family members that are older or maybe susceptible to the coronavirus or themselves. You have players that have weaker immune systems, whether it's genetic, or we have cancer survivors and things like that. So there'll be players that will not, and coaches as well, and referees, everyone involved, or support staff, that will not be participating in these events. So that's just health-wise. And you'll have your few that will not play for their social justice endeavors, and that's fine as well. I have no problems with that. That's their life. I've learned long ago not to judge another man or woman for the path they want to take, even if they are famous or celebrities or whatever walk of life they have. I may disagree with it, but they're human. They want to do it. If they are willing to walk away from money and their profession, that's up to them. But we're going to see this happen quite a bit as far as some of these players and coaches and staff. So I want to just put that out there, because it was national news that they're going to have players dealing with it. And that does transition into the Miscellaneous Department as far as other sporting endeavors that have been taking place. As I mentioned, we are in a world right now where sports and politics are significantly impacting each other in big ways. And I'm not mad at the athletes for expressing their opinions, but if I disagree with it, and that's fine. And I can even slightly respect it, or not even acknowledge it. So I say I don't have to respect it or acknowledge it. As I mentioned with Kyrie and Dwight Howard, I disagree with that opinion. I would not go that route, but that's up to them. That's their life. That's what they want to do. Now, the league measurements, messages, and statements, we've all, every league at this point is, we have bad, you know, we stand behind our black or African-American, if they want to be legally correct, the our fellow players and fellow man, and even utter the world's black words, Black Lives Matter, which I think is a, you got to be very careful with using that terminology if you are an executive or a player for that matter, but more if you're an executive, because you're representing a, your league or you're representing your business. But even Roger Goodell, who's represents the NFL, which is probably the most conservative brand or conservatively led professional league, he even said Black Lives Matter. So we're in a different world. But these leagues, it's easy to say all of this stuff right now, and because it's obvious, and it just goes into other things as well. Arguing against police brutality and other things like that, very easy to do. Unless you're a cold-hearted person, you don't want to see innocent people or people that are at a disadvantage being brutalized and murdered, literally, by law enforcement. That's an easy statement. Where do you go from there with it? Where do these leagues go with it? Do they set up funds for minorities? Do they allow their players to... We've already heard players saying they're going to kneel. Even Bill O'Brien, head coach of the Houston Texans, a team in the NFL, he said he's going to kneel when they return to play. Are they going to allow that? Are we going to have team leagues or federations like U.S. Soccer or the NBA for that matter? People don't know the NBA has a rule against kneeling for the national anthem. It's just not discussed because they have a better relationship. The owners and the players have a better relationship. It's not great, but it's better than the NFL. But that's why you haven't seen a player kneel. But technically, it is illegal for a player to do that. Will the NBA go back into their legal books and allow kneeling? Is that a sign of the league showing approval? We've talked about the Rooney Rule many times. The NFL, the allow or the requirement of now two minorities to be interviewed for a head coaching position. We don't see that in other leagues. Are they going to start doing that? Are we going to start seeing that with general managers or presidents, even ownership? If a team is for sale, are you required to have a minority-led group, whether it's a sole proprietor or of a group, or even require a minority be in that ownership group? Where, what steps do they make from here? A lot of this stuff is superficial, and it's very easy to do right now, and we're kind of responding to the way things are right now because you don't want to be the league or the federation that's not for, obviously, you know, in essence about equality and respectability of your fellow human being. That's very easy to say and make these statements right now. But what happens when, what, and soccer has deals this quite a bit internationally, or in MLS as well, we've seen this and this there. What happens when fans are in the stands and racially insensitive statements are made to players or to coaches? What happens then? We've seen NASCAR make their presence felt in this regard, banning the Confederate flag. Personally, I'm not caught up on flags and statues because it tends to mask the real issues as far as where to, it's, what I'm trying to say is that you can take down a statue of a monument where it's related to Confederacy or someone that has been Confederacy in here in the United States, specifically in the Southeast, or of someone that has done human harm and yet they're memorialized in some way. If you're listening to this outside the United States, we see that happen quite a bit. Or symbolisms as far as flags. We have a Confederate flag here in the United States in the center south. Oh, Confederate flags around the country. And that tends to represent a different era of the United States, a different part, a different time. And that gets tied into some racial, racist beliefs. So in NASCAR, and they're based in the South. They race around the country, but it's a Southeastern sport for the most part. Very sensitive to it. They've banned the Confederate flag from being at the at the different tracks, which is a fair move. I'm not mad at that at all. And because they're not banning these people from having it in their home or even driving around with it in their car. I've seen it both. That's your home. It's your property. Do whatever you want there. But it's easy to do that now because there are no fans in the stands. What happens when they start having fans back into the stadium or the tracks? You're going to see people try to sneak it in. What happens then? Will there be an official to take the flag away from that patron? Or will the other patrons turn their back or point out, hey, he has a Confederate flag. He shouldn't be doing that. What happens then? So we'll see what happens, but it's a move that should have been made, I think, a while ago, and a move that was necessary. I even think even having bringing the American flag, I said I'm not a big flag guy, but if you're going to go there, it's an interesting slope or a different perspective, different view or interesting way that you're going to approach it as far as do you don't tread on me. We've seen that flag as well. It's the yellow and green flag with the snake. That has interesting symbolism as well. It's not as extreme, well, not to say extreme, but not as known or acknowledged as Confederate flag is, but that flag has interesting, if you do your research, interesting means of what that can represent. Will that be eliminated? You know, so things like that. It's a lot going on there. So NASCAR, they're trying to do their thing. I was happy to see the PGA Tour back in action yesterday, the Charles Schwab Challenge in Texas. It was very good to actually see some live golf. And as we've said on the show before, the more individual the sport is, the more likely and quickly it can return. I joke about it myself too when you see the cornhole tournaments on ESPN, but they've been going strong. We've seen the fishing tournaments, sort of the Bassmaster Classic, that's been going on. Those are individual sports. Social distancing is very easy to do in those sports. And the cornhole, no, they're standing next to each other, you and your opponent, throwing your beanbag towards the target. But you wear a mask, you'll be all right. Golf is starting to see that as well. We saw all the players without masks on participating in the tournament, no fans in the gallery, the social distancing practiced. But it's you and the ball, and you're hitting it on a golf course with a lot of space. So that's a sport that's very easy to execute as far as that goes. I think tennis will be next. That's going to happen in the very near future. But I said, it was just good to see some live sports going on. Now, Xander Schauffele, he was leading the tournament, and he looked like he was going to take home the title. He played really well, 17th hole. He missed an easy putt that would have given him that. He was at 15 under at the time, and a par there would have probably put him, kept him at 15 under, and he would have been able to participate in the playoffs. But he missed the putt. I mean, it was right down the middle, but I don't know if it hit a blade or maybe a divot in the ball. It went wide a little bit, went in and out of the hole, and he finished at 14 under, one shot out of being in the playoff. And I said he was leading for the most part on Sunday, but he missed that putt, and that led to a playoff between Daniel Berger and Colin Morikawa. Berger was able to win the tournament, took home $1.35 million. And now Xander, he did win $366,000. But still, you miss out on nearly $1 million just by that missed putt. Now, he still would have had to go to 18 and probably par there as well and then win the playoff, which would have been a three-man tournament. But still, at least there was some drama there. And as I said, you watched that putt. I don't know how it did not go in. But it was just very good to see live sports taking place over the weekend. And finally, we'll wrap up on Major League Baseball. They're continuing to struggle to find their way back onto the field. Now, Rob Manfred has made that promise. He did it when the Major League Baseball draft took place last week. During that broadcast, where he did an interview with some of the media, he said that they are going to play a season, and he wants players to get off the 100% salary demand. Now, as a commissioner, he can say a season is taking place. He can set a date and a time and location. He can say starting on July 10th, we're going to have a 60-game season take place, and this is the schedule. These are where the games are going to be, and we're going to have a season. Now, we're going to have, if he does that, though, the players are probably going to counter and strike, and that just, they're already in a tenuous situation because the CBA, collective bargaining agreement, ends after the 2021 season. So not this season, but the next season. But the general rule of thumb is in all professional sports is that you don't want to go into a lame duck year as far as your negotiations go, because once you do that, you're most likely going to have a player stoppage of some form, because you don't want to have negotiations during the season. That usually is not the way that it works. Similar to players, you don't want to, or head coaches, you don't want to go into a final year of your contract without an extension. It very rarely do you have a final year play out and then you go straight to negotiations as a free agent in that regard, if it's both teams or both parties want to continue the relationship. So they've made offers, and the players have made counteroffers, but now Major League Baseball is saying no more counteroffers. This is where it goes. This is where we stand. I think there's going to be a season, because I think Manfred is going to employ one, but it's going to be a 50-game season with 100% of the salary guaranteed. And the 50-game season itself, at first I didn't like it, and I still don't like it because it's baseball. 50 games is not enough, I think, to indicate a true best team, because even a team that's the worst can get on a good run, or a team that's the best can have it just doesn't seem like it'll be a good regular season. Now, we'll say if you're a team in the bottom half of the standings, a team that traditionally does not do well, you have a better shot this year than any, because the reason teams like the Yankees and the Dodgers and the Astros are able to win, and the Nationals, they've been a really good team the past few years, it's in a war of attrition. They have the deepest rosters. They can handle the most injuries. They can substitute. Their benches are better than a lower half team that's in the major rebuild, like a Detroit or a Chicago White Sox right now, or a Texas Rangers, teams that are in the bottom half of the standings, or Miami Marlins, you know, teams that are just not at the best right now. You have a 50-game season. Maybe those players get off to fast starts, and maybe a team that's, you know, 25, well, let's see, if it's 50, we'll go that way. Maybe a team that's 30-20, even the worst team in baseball can put together a 50-game stretch of 30-20. It can happen. So you put that together, maybe the Marlins find their way into the playoffs. But on the other side of things, even the best teams, as I mentioned, the preseason favorites are probably Yankees, Dodgers, you know, as far as the teams in the National League and the American League, they can have a stretch where they go 20-30 during a season. That's going to happen. But then the rest of the games, they play at a very high level, and you get to your 95-100 wins, and you go from there. But any team can go have a 20-30 stretch. You do that, you're not going to be in the playoffs most likely. So it adds some intrigue and excitement if you're a team, if you're a supporter of a team that's usually not doing very well or has a weaker roster. But if you're going to have 50 games, you have to expand the playoffs. It's almost going to be to the point where it can't be the traditional, and they already were adding the seventh team into the playoffs. You may have to have 10 or 12 teams from each league in the playoffs if it's 50 games, just to make it fair and objective. And because the more games you play, maybe the stronger team will work its way through. But at this point, I think you're reaching a level of apathy among sports fans as far as that league goes. because people are starting to find other things to do. The weather has turned around the country. It's good. Though things are opening up a lot more. I've seen so many messages from friends and family in states like New York and California, states that were not as open as we are here in Georgia. People are starting to go to the supermarket now. I've seen statements of leaving my house for the first time in months, or first time going to supermarket in 2 months, things like that, literally. And when people find they're finally out, they're living life, that's when you're going to start seeing less interest. If baseball is going to bicker, because the perception is you have billionaire owners and millionaire players bickering over money, I'm going to watch a movie, I'm going to go to the park, or I'm going to watch another sport. Basketball is going to be back, most likely. I'm not a big soccer fan, hypothetically, but MLS is playing, I'm going to watch a soccer match. The golf is back, I'm going to watch some of that during the weekend. And then once you get towards August, that's when the NFL comes around, and the NFL is the king sport. They're the top dog. We're going to see a training camp in starting in August. Now, it might be a different training camp than normal. You're not going to see the fans be able to go to practice and things like that. But once you get towards August, people start thinking about the NFL, and that's what's going to lead to coverage. Baseball is going to work its way out of the national sports conversation if they do not play games. And that's just the reality that they're dealing with. So all this bickering and all the complaining from both sides, there are no winners in that regard. Because while I may care about Mike Trout and Steven Strasburg and what their opinions are, and Tony Clark, the head of the players union, and I read about or hear from Rob Manfred, and who represents the owners as the MLB commissioner, average fans don't care about that stuff. They just want to see a ball game, and they want to see their players participating in some way, whether it's on TV or if it's a limited amount of fans in the stands. They want to see all of that. But if you have all of these players arguing and dealing with all that, they're not going to care. And Major League Baseball, they have the oldest fan base out of all the major professional sports in the United States. Average age, you look at certain studies, about 50 to 55 years old. You're going to turn off an entire young generation. I'm 39, and even I'm considered a young fan in baseball. That's bad. If I'm considered a young fan, I'm not old in life, but as far as sports fandom, you want to have a majority of your fans, you're going to buy your fans 35 and under. You really want to have, and that's what the NBA does very well. NFL does very well in that regard, where you have a younger, and even MLS, you look at their numbers. Now, they're not as big as, I'm not going to say MLS is bigger than Major League Baseball, but you look at the trend, and baseball is never going to go away. It's like boxing. It's like horse racing. You're not going to see Major League Baseball end, but when you look at boxing and you look at horse racing, they have an older fan base, and they have slowly moved away from national conversation. Sure, an occasional heavyweight title fight. We saw Fury and Wilder over in boxing, or in the Kentucky Derby takes place. You have everyone, they throw some money down because they like the horse race. But when you have the secondary boxers fight, well, I say secondary not in their professionalism, but lesser known fighters, or when it's not the Triple Crown in horse racing, they struggle to gain ratings and advertisements and media attention, social media and otherwise. Major League Baseball can go down that path, or they're heading down that path 10, 15 years from now if they're not careful. And the cancellation of a season over this would be silly. So they have to figure that out. I think they will, but there are going to be a lot of bruised egos on all sides. And that concludes today's show. Thanks for listening to our broadcast. As always, head to thesportsinquirer.net for everything that we're doing. Social media platforms, Twitter and Instagram and Facebook. Just search Sports Inquirer, all one word, and you can find us there. And finally, you go to our YouTube and SoundCloud pages under The Sports Inquirer, and you can see everything that we are doing there and get archives of our shows from the past, keep up to date what we're doing now, and get updates for what we're going to do in the future. So until next time, good fight, good night, and be safe.